Our guests tonight have opposing views on the overtime issue. Daniel Mitchell is senior fellow at the Cato Institute, and Ross Eisenbray is vice president of the Economic Policy Institute. Dan, let me start with you, because you are opposed to this proposal. Tell us why. I mean, what are the drawbacks of giving people who are working extra long hours some more money?
First, I have a philosophical objection. I don't think that the government, politicians or bureaucrats, should interfere between consenting adults who want to have an employment contract. Now, that being said, I wish there was some magic fairy who could sprinkle down pay raise dust on all of us. The reality is, if government is going to impose a cost, somebody's going to bear that cost. Now, a lot of people in the administration and elsewhere seem to think that businesses are some never-ending well of money that can be tapped, whether it's Obamacare premiums, whether it's higher minimum wages, or whether it's now this overtime initiative. The reality is, when you make it more expensive to hire workers, you're going to get fewer workers hired. And when you make it more costly to have certain workers in a category where they're subjected to overtime, guess what? Their base pay may go down. Fewer than may be in that category. There are going to be real-world consequences, because there is no magic fairy up there who sprinkles money on us.
You know, Mr. Eisenbray, fairies or not, Dan makes some very interesting points here. I mean, number one, why should the government be involved in setting the rates of pay if, as you say, the share of the national income going to labor is 42%? That suggests that labor is willing to take that amount of pay. And secondly, Dan makes the point that if you charge more for something, you get less bought of it. Answer.
Well, one thing you'll get less of, if you don't pay for it, you'll get workers working more overtime. That's clear. And that leads to hardship on them and their families. It leads to a lot of stress in people's lives. So if employers are going to make people work extra long hours, they should pay for it. And the workers obviously are going to benefit from that. The notion that we can't have the government involved in this is crazy. The government has been setting overtime rules since 1938. And back in the days when we had the strongest economy, fast-growing incomes across the board, not just for the 1% or the very top of the income scale, we had strong regulation of overtime rules. And what I'm proposing is that we go back to the Ford and Nixon administration, you know, and look at what they did. The economy was good back then, and there's no reason that we can't have those rules again.
So, Dan, I'd like you to react to what Ross is saying. Should we go back to the era of, past times, and to make this a little bit more of a robust economy by paying people more?
Wow, I've never heard somebody say we should go back to those boom years of the 1970s. Here's where, though, I think Ross and I might have some common ground. There's no question that the best thing we can do for workers, whether they're the lowest paid or, for that matter, middle class or above, the best thing is good economic growth. But here's where we'll have a difference. I don't think making our economy more like France, more like Italy, more like Greece, with more regulation, more government mandates, higher taxes, more spending, I don't think that's the recipe to get faster growth. If we want more job creation, if we want higher pay, we need a tight labor market. That means more growth, and I think you get that by reducing the burden of government. So I think we should be going in the opposite direction. Yes, let's go back to the era when we had fast growth, but it wasn't the 1970s. It was the 1980s and 90s under Reagan, and that's when the burden of government was falling, not rising.
Mr. Eisenbray, we've got about 30 seconds here. Why don't you answer what Dan says? And I think what you were saying there was to go back to the levels or the thresholds of the 1970s.
That's right.
Not necessarily, when in inflation-adjusted terms, the overtime threshold was closer to $1,000. But you know, people who work overtime do get paid for the extra work. It's a question of whether they get paid that shift differential of the time and a half, right?
That's right. They should be paid time and a half for their overtime. I did interviews today with workers who had worked 20 and 30 extra hours in a week and hadn't gotten paid for it. And they said what's obvious. If they had been paid, if they'd had the extra at the end of the year, $5,000 or $10,000 in their paycheck, they would have been able to spend that money on car payments, on putting money aside for a home mortgage. They would have done things that would spur the economy, which is slow, not because of, that capital doesn't get its share. It's because workers don't have enough money to spend.
All right, Ross, we're going to have to leave it there. You get the last word. Sorry, Dan, but thank you, gentlemen, both for coming on the program. Daniel Mitchell of the Cato Institute and Ross Eisenbray from the Economic Policy Institute.